In my Bible, it says, God's angel to prepare the way. And I'll go ahead and read that. I'm just going to read 20 through 31. See, I am sending an angel ahead of you to guard you along the way and to bring you to the place I have prepared. Pay attention to him and listen to what he says. Do not rebel against him. He will not forgive your rebellion, since my name is in him. If you listen carefully to what he says and do all that I say, I will be an enemy to your enemies, and I will oppose those who oppose you. My angel will go ahead of you to bring you to the land of the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And I will wipe them out. Do not bow down before their gods or worship them or follow their practices. You must demolish them, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I will make all your enemies turn their back and run. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, Canaanites, and Hittites out of the way. But I will not drive them out in a single year because the land would become desolate and animals too numerous for you. Little by little, I will drive them out before you until you have increased enough to take possession of the land. I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea and from the desert to the Euphrates River. I will give into your hands the people who live in the land, and you will drag them out before you. So when I read this, I took it as like how God can make a way in your life. And when I think of like how God can make a way in your life, I just think that sometimes God is sending all of us, he's sending us wisdom or something, some word, and we missed it because our attention is somewhere else. And I think that's important because it's sometimes we just need to slow down, be still, and know that just let God be God. Like, it's sometimes he's sending us wisdom and our priorities or something, we're not focused on him, and we miss something very important that's a part of who we are and what our assignment is. In verse 22, I love this. I think this is God's character in a sentence. I will be an enemy to your enemies. So when I think of that, like, who has children here? Anyone have children? So, Nick, but that's fine. Oh, I will be an enemy to your enemies. Think of it as you, as a parent. How would you feel if someone was talking bad about your kid? You wouldn't like it. Think about how the creator of us thinks. Think of that. I will be an enemy to your enemies. We have backup that some people don't know that they have, and I think that's really important. I also think it's important that sometimes we're waiting for God to show up, but he's waiting for us to grow up as a person. I think sometimes you do need to think about it. Like, am I doing something for the kingdom, or is this kind of just for my own? But I just want to push that God is constantly working in us. It's not like, oh, I'll talk to him a couple years. Like, he's all right. I'll leave alone. No, it's constant. But I really want to talk that, like, from the scripture, we can know that God gives you resources to deal with your responsibilities. Like, the resources are always before the assignment, though. That's what I love about God. Like, he will give you resources to deal with your assignment, and it's always before. It's never like he just throws something at you and you have to, like, what is this? No, it's always before, because from God, it's the greater the assignment that we have, the greater the assistance from God. And I really think this is important. Like, the people in the scripture waited 400 years to be delivered out of slavery. 400 years. Like, think of the generations. Like, that must have just tore them apart. And they were so used to just waiting for God to show up. They were just kind of like, all right, I guess he'll come next generation in a couple hundred years. No. Well, God was ready. Like, he was so ready to send them to the promised land that they talk about. And they were waiting. They were waiting because they were stuck in a life stage. And how many of us have been stuck in a life stage in our life? Like, you're stuck, and you're just stuck in a life stage that God set you free from 10 years ago. Like, it's so important to acknowledge that God's got it, guys. Like, anyone have pets or dogs? I have two dogs, and I mean, I can let them outside because we have a fence. And I think when I hear that, you're like, okay, what's this going to? I can let them outside and go inside and not worry about it because they have a fence. They have a perimeter. Or I can let them free. And I think God does the same thing for us. Because when God establishes parameters for our lives, what he is doing is giving you permission to enjoy his promises. And I think with that, like within the parameters of his principles, though, it's his principles. Sometimes we think about it like, it's God. I mean, God is establishing parameters for our lives. If you're taking notes, the three main points I'm going to talk about tonight. Number one is God will protect his people, guys. God's got you. And specifically, in verse 20, he talks about, I will guard you along the way. And I was sitting there just thinking about, what is the way? Like, what is that? Like, what is the way? But sometimes God is guarding you from something you didn't even know you need guarded from. And I think that's important. Like, you won't see it until you're walking. I mean, sometimes he's guarding you, but you gotta look back on life and you're like, God made it through me. God did that? God let me through that? That was not me. There's no way it could have been me. And I think we all can admit that there's something in our lives that there's no way. And I think this is just a side note, but in order for God to protect you, you have to be moving, right? To look back on life. You cannot be stuck. Because in my life, like, I'm 19 years old, I was in high school last year, like, there was a lot of insecurity, and I mean, everyone in high school has some insecurities. Like, my freshman, sophomore year, I was in a terrible car accident. There was a certain things that just, like, tore me down and made me very insecure. I had a really bad sports injury that pretty much ended my sports career. I mean, I lived my whole life playing sports, and it just kind of ended real quick. And within that, I mean, people would make fun of me because they thought it was a fake injury. I mean, it tore me down. I was a sophomore in high school, freshman in that area. I mean, it tore me apart. With those insecurities, though, the way I overcame them, this is going to sound weird, I did the work. And what I mean by that is, like, I served God. Like, I found a way to serve God anyway. And within that, like, it just kind of went away. The certain insecurities will always be in your life, but some of them can go. And it's from serving God. But God never said he'll make it easy. Like, if you will not get assistance from God if you ask him to make it easier. And don't try to fulfill someone else's assignment. Like, do what you do, but do it well. Try to be the best at what you can be. I think that's so important. Don't try to be someone else. It's so important to acknowledge that, because we have the same spirit that rose Jesus from the dead inside of all of us. Mm-hmm. Like, it is thriving inside of us. Like, the same spirit that rose Jesus 3 days after, it's inside of us. God's second promise is he will position us. So sometimes God puts you where you do not want to be. And I think in my life, it was junior, senior year, I was applying for colleges, just like a typical high school student, but I mean, I had choices. Like, I applied for college in Grand Rapids and Vermilion, South Dakota, USD. But in the Grand Rapids, I was just kind of leaning towards that. I was like, this is my college. I mean, it's a ministry college. It's a Bible college. It's something that I want to do. I want to study further in. It was a process. I had like an hour interview on the phone. It was awful. And then an hour interview, they had to interview someone from a staff from the church I go to, just to kind of prove that, like, I'm a real person, like, I want to further the kingdom. And then it was like, boom, like, I got clotheslined, like, God clotheslined me. I was like, oh, I'm not going to Grand Rapids, I guess I'm going to USD. I don't know why, I was like, but God positioned me for a higher priority than my own, I think, because I think I'm going to a college that's lost and that needs God. Mm-hmm. And, I think it's so important to acknowledge that God can set you up. He can get all the way there. He can set you up, but he will not take the step for you. And what I mean by that is, like, if he took the step for you or me, it definitely would have not been kindness. It would have been cruelty, because he is pushing me somewhere that my faith is not prepared for. This statement I've said to people, and they're like, what does that mean? Well, God's promises are not automatic. And what I mean by that is they're optional. Like, they have to be acquired by faith. You have to take that step. You have to take that step of faith to acknowledge it. We have to take the step. joy, happiness, peace, whatever it is in your life, it's there. I mean, it's always there. Like, God has it set for you. You just have to take that step. My last one of this, anyways, is God will, this is a dirty word, prepare you. And just kind of how Nick touched a little bit, but from sixth grade through freshman year, like, I went to a small group on Wednesday nights for free pizza and friends and girls or whatever, but I did not go for the right reasons, but I did not know that I was soaking in content and soaking in God's word. It was there, like, but I didn't take anything of it. And I mean, just through certain circumstances, like I said before, like, God clotheslined me. Like, it was ruthless. Like, it was sophomore night. I mean, I just got clotheslined. It was like, just came out of nowhere, and I didn't know what hit me. And it was like, kind of had to sit there, like, the next day. I was like, what was that? But this step is not fun, guys. Like, being prepared for something, because it's little by little. It's not all at once. He doesn't do it all at once. It's little by little, but it's uncomfortable. But I think when you're uncomfortable, that's where you get the most growth in life. Because there are so many people who got to the edge of a blessing, went all that way, but missed out. They went all that way and did not take it. Because God said, I will go before you, but I won't go for you. Our own faith has to take that step. 3 years of my high school career was a very sinful, anxiety-based relationship that I was in. Like, just tore me apart. It just tore me apart as a person. And what I think that taught me was, like, yeah, I could have, like, I just didn't have what I needed. Like, I just was trying to end it. I mean, it was just anxiety-based, just anxiety attack after anxiety attack. Just have to go to the hospital to think I'm having a heart attack as a 17-year-old. Like, that big of anxiety. I heard these two sentences, and I was like, what does this mean? Like, you will never be more loved by God than you are right now, tonight, right now. And you will never be more forgiven than you are right now, by God, right now. What I mean by that is, like, we expect sanctification to work like salvation, and it doesn't work like that. Because the difference between those two is forgiveness and freedom. Forgiveness, it's all at once. What Christ did on the cross is enough for us. Like, that was over the top. What he did is, it's enough for us. I mean, it's done. You are forgiven the second it happens. You ask God to be in your heart, you are forgiven. Freedom, little by little. Do you guys have anything in your life that you expected God to remove? If you have your Bibles, again, take them out to 2 Corinthians 12. This is one of my favorite verses ever. This is Paul, if I can get to it. 2 Corinthians 12:7. Or because of these surpassingly great revelations, therefore, in order to keep me from being conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. When you hear that, he says, I was given. So, like, a gift. So that's kind of weird. He said, I got a gift from Satan. That's kind of like, all right, Paul, what are you doing, dude? But no, it's a gift because we're in a space called grace when he gives us this. God keeps us in that, keeps that thorn in your flesh so you can be in a space called grace. Paul never said what his thorn was, and I'm so happy he never said what the thorn was, because now we all can relate to Paul. He says, in order from being conceited. See, if we didn't have a thorn in our flesh, we wouldn't need God. We wouldn't need him. The enemy's tool of torment is God's tool for transformation. See, we better understand Exodus 23 now, just a little bit. Just those promises. He will protect you, position you, and prepare you. But I want you to know that it's not just the angels God sends ahead of us. It's the no's, because sometimes God uses those no's to lead you to a greater yes. And I think that's important to just acknowledge that whatever your assignment is, that whatever you think of your assignment, whatever that is in the future, or whatever God's preparing you for, like, sometimes it's not going to work. Like, I mean, sometimes we're stuck. You're stuck in a life stage. You just have to acknowledge that our weaknesses will always lead to God's strength. When I say that, it's like, so what is your assignment? What is your assignment? I want you guys to seriously think about what your assignment is.